for me to be here. I just want to thank Pastor Mark and Jennifer and Trisha Gunn. You all are such a beautiful picture of God's grace to come together as one church in the same city, on the same team, with the same focus, which is Jesus. And it's just beautiful to see. So I just want you to know that blesses me more than you will ever know to see that. That, you know, a lot of times under the law, we're in competition with one another, you know. We're worried about that church and that church and this church stealing and this from. When you're under grace, it's all about Jesus. We're all on the same team. We're all equal in Christ. We're one in Him. And we rejoice with one another. Amen? I was telling Trisha, she had texted me not too long ago and told me she got invited to Creflo, Creflo Dollars Conference. What's that called? Grace Life Conference. And I was so excited for her. I was jumping up and down on the inside. And I told her, I said, you know what, Trisha? I said, under the law, people are jealous when something opens like that. I says, but under grace, when you're up there preaching, I'm up there preaching. Because we're one with Jesus. And as long as He is being glorified, as long as He is being pointed to, I am right behind you, girl. And I'm coming to that conference. I'm going to be in the front row going cheerleading for Trisha Gunn. Woohoo! And that's what grace does for you. That's what understanding who you are does for you. You know that you're the favorite one and so are you. I'm the favorite one. I'm blessed and so are you. I'm loved and so are you. Woo! And when you really believe that, this is when we're truly able to love one another. You know, we can never really love one another under the law. The law does not produce love. Did you know that? It tells us to love. It commands us to love. But it doesn't give us the power to love. Because the scripture says faith comes by love. Believing God, the fruit of God's Spirit, comes by knowing how much we are loved. And when we live in the love of Jesus comes out of us for everyone else. And we're no longer comparing with one another anymore. We're no longer competing with each other anymore. We're rejoicing with one another because we know as Jesus is, so are we in this world. So what's true about you is true about Jesus, is true about me. We're equally loved in Jesus, right? Amen. All right, so this morning, I want to talk to you about the title of my message is The true gospel, the greatest love story ever told. You know, I wrestled, to be honest with you, I wrestled with Jesus just a little bit about this message because of you men in here. I did, you know, because I'm going to be talking about our identity as the bride of Christ this morning. And I'm thinking to myself, Lord, there's going to be a lot of men out there. They might not receive what I'm going to say. But He said to me, Connie, it is important. It is important for them to open up their hearts and receive that they are one with Jesus, because that's what the bride of Christ really means, is that we've been joined as one with the King of Kings. Do you know what that means? In the Song of Songs, in the Passion Translation, Jesus is talking to the bride and He says, you are my beloved, my equal, my bride, you are beauty itself to me. I mean, religious demons will come out when you start saying that you're equal with Jesus. I mean, even as I say that, you're probably going, equal with Jesus. But He gave us His righteousness. He didn't give us some, you know, lesser than righteousness. He didn't give us some lesser than holiness. He didn't, do you understand what I'm saying? He gave us His perfect righteousness. His perfect holiness, not something that we did to gain it, but something He gave to us as a gift on our wedding day when we said yes to Jesus. We became equal with the King of Kings. And this gift that He gave us, our wedding gift of righteousness, is what causes us to be free from shame and fear in this world. When we understand that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, that He sees no flaw in us, that He sees no fault in us, that our sins are completely wiped away from the east to the west. When he looks at us, he sees holiness and beauty, and it doesn't matter what we've done wrong. It doesn't matter what we've done today. Our identity never changes. And when we understand we're one with Jesus, like I said already, we live loved and we are empowered to love. Yeah. And that's what Jesus said. They will know me by your love for one another. Woo! Glory! So I'm going to start out this morning with this scripture. And I hope it can come up on the for y'all to see. Isaiah 54, 4 through 5 in the New Living Translation. Oh, I just want to see how fast y'all were. Okay. It says this. Fear not, you will no longer live in shame. Don't be afraid. There is no more disgrace for you. You will no longer remember the shame of your youth and the sorrows of widowhood, for your Creator will be your husband. The Lord of heaven's armies is his name. He is your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, the God of all the earth. You know, this is my theme scripture. I mean, I've meditated on the scripture, pondered on the scripture. This is a powerful scripture. Jesus is telling us, don't be afraid. You'll no longer live in fear. You will no longer live in shame. And I just want to tell you, the word that jumps out at me is the word live. You will no longer live in shame. Is it up there now? No?
It was.
You will no longer live in shame. That doesn't mean that it's not going to come at you. It doesn't mean that you're not going to be tempted by it. But you're no longer going to live in it.
Amen.
See, I've been a Christian for 40-some years. And I used to live in shame. I was the bride of the King of Kings. Like I told the ladies at the Women of Grace Conference, when you were joined to Jesus, you became, He is the I Am. And when we're joined to Jesus, we become Mrs. I Am. We become, you know, our identities have changed. And I was sharing how when I was born, on my birth certificate said Connie Beckham. That's who I was. My identity was Connie Beckham. But when I married my husband, who was Tony Witter, my name changed. And I took on his identity. Well, the same thing happened in the gospel of grace, in the kingdom of God. When you said yes to Jesus, you took on his name. Everything he has belongs to you. You're everything he is, he gave to you. You're one with him. Oh my goodness, to understand the revelation of what that really means. When you touch somebody, Jesus is touching them. When you pray for somebody, Jesus is praying for him. Greater is he that's within us, right, than he that's in this world.
Yes.
Oh my, we have been crucified with Christ.
Yes.
It is no longer we who live, but Christ lives in us. In this life we live, in this body we live by faith, by the faith of the Son of God, who gave himself for us, who loved us. We're living by the faith of Jesus. Did you know that scripture really says the faith of Jesus? And the way I think about that is, I live, you live by what Jesus believes about us. We're not living anymore by what we believe about us or what somebody else believes about us. We're living by what our Jesus believes about us. Because we've been crucified, you know. Like I said, Connie Beckham, she's no longer in existence anymore. True? You look me up, my social security number, everything I have, it says Connie Witter. Well, I'm also Mrs. I Am, because I'm married to the King of Kings. I'm married to the great I Am. I'm married to the one who heals, the healer of all the earth, the creator of all the earth, the one that put the stars in the sky and the fish in the sea, the one that made you and me. The all-powerful one, the one that nothing is impossible with, the one who says he's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ever hope or dream. That's who we're married to. We're married. I said at the conference, and if you've been there, you're hearing it again. When we were joined to Jesus, We didn't become deity. In other words, we're not God, right? We all know that, right? He is God. He is the Savior. He's the rescuer. He's the deliverer. And we aren't. Aren't you glad? Okay, so what does it mean that we're equal to him? We're not deity. What it means that we're equal to him is that we have his righteousness. That he qualified us for every promise of God. We are completely qualified, not because of what we've done, but because of what Jesus did for us on the cross. It's in his finished work that we can rest, because all the promises of God are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. We became an heir of all of his promises. We became an heir of his righteousness and his holiness. But he is still the rescuer, the Savior, the deliverer. So guess what? We might not be the rescuer, the Savior, the deliverer, but we're married to him. And so that means if we need rescuing or somebody we love needs rescuing, we can trust our husband. We can trust the one we're joined to do the rescuing, to do the saving, to do the delivering. We don't have to fix everybody. Aren't you happy? We don't have to fix our children. We don't have to fix our husband. We don't have to fix our wife. We don't have to do it anymore. The position of Savior has been filled, and you don't need to apply.
Amen.
Woohoo! And I'll tell you what, one of the things that brings fear in my heart the most, and I'm just telling you, being honest with you, is my children struggling. My husband maybe not making the right choice or doing something not right. You know, that puts a little fear in me. Like, for example, me and my husband, we own a business and making decisions all the time about this business. And, you know, you can be afraid that you're going to make a wrong decision. Come on, somebody. Right? And so I have to take, I can go, and this is how I used to do. And I'm just going to set some of y'all free right now just by this one story. I used to go and say, you know, maybe you should do this and maybe you should do that. And I think this might be good. What am I doing when I tell him what I think and what he should do? And I'm trying to rescue. I'm trying to save. I'm trying to make it right. But when I go to my husband, my natural husband, and I say this, you hear from God. You do not follow a stranger. God makes your thoughts agreeable to his will, and your plans will be established and succeed. I'm saying what the Savior says, and he is responsible for making that happen in his life. All my part is to say yes to Jesus. That's all I have to do is say yes to Jesus. I am reminding my husband, you remind your husband, when you're Mrs. I Am, you look to him and you say, Jesus, what do you say about this? You're the rescuer. You're the deliverer. You're the fixer. You're the one that is capable of all things. What do you say about this? When I'm concerned, for example, about a decision my husband's making, and he always reminds me, Connie, I am busying myself with his every step. I am busying myself with his. Isn't that what the scriptures say? That the Lord will lead and guide us, the feet of the righteous, and he will busy himself with our every step. Yes. Now, when you say yes to that, what happens in your heart? Peace. Peace comes when you say yes to Jesus. Wow. I tell you what, I get up here with all these scriptures and I just hardly get to any of them. But since I have 30 minutes, I'm going to try. Okay, I want to share something with you. Oh, thank you, Jesus. In my journey of growing in the understanding of his love and his grace, about 4 years ago, I was just talking to the Father, and I was like, Lord, I want to grow deeper and higher. You know, the scripture says to know the love of Christ, to know the height, the depth, the breadth, the length, that you might be filled with the fullness of God. And according to this power, what is this power? It's his love. The context of that passage of scripture, of God being able to do exceedingly abundantly above all you could ever hope or dream, is the power of love. It's what the power of love is able to do when we understand how much we're loved, when we understand what Jesus did for us, when we're living in that love and allowing the revelation of that love to change us. It says God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ever hope or dream. And so I'm like, Jesus, I want to grow in your love. I want to know it deeper. I want to know it higher. I want to know it wider. There's a scripture in the Message Bible in 1 Corinthians 14:1. It says, go after a life of love as though your life depended on it, because it does. My life depends. Me living this Jesus life, me living as a bride of Christ, me living as a son of God, me living as a child of God. I mean, living it out, not just being told that's who I am. I want to experience who I am, don't you? It all comes through a revelation of love. And so I was just asking him, Lord, I want, and he said, Connie, I'm going to take you to the Song of Songs. This is where you're going to be blown away by this beautiful love story of how much I have passionately pursued you, how much I love you, what I've done for you in a deeper way to understand. And so this is how the Greatest Love Story Bible study series that I've been that I just started teaching last Wednesday came about. 4 years ago, I taught it. Now I'm reteaching it, and I'm going to grow deeper and higher and wider again, because it was the Bible study, and I've taught many that has just like opened my eyes even greater and wider. You know, it's never, there's never an end to knowing him, right? He is love, and our determined purpose is to know love. So in my journey of growing in this, he took me to a book called The Christian Love Story, and it was a book by a Jewish man, Levitt, I think is his name, is that right? Zola Levitt. And in this Christian Love Story, he talks about what a Jewish man does, the process he goes through to propose to a bride, to show a bride how much he loves her, in hopes that she'll say yes to him. So this Christian love story, again, there was five things in this book, and that's so beautiful because it's the number of grace. Five things that happened in this process of a Jewish man. It's this natural, truest traditions of what they do in order for a woman to become their bride. And the five things are: the covenant, a covenant is made, a bridal price, the cup of acceptance, the gifts, the bridal gifts, and the bridal chamber. And after those five things have happened, there's a great marriage celebration. And this is how, you know, I didn't know this because I'm not Jew, you know, but guess who is? Jesus was a Jew, and he knew this. This was the tradition that they went through to win the bride. And so as I share the story with you about how this comes about, you're going to hear the beautiful gospel of Jesus Christ in it. What happens is the son, the Jewish son, comes to his father. And when he finds a bride, when he sees a bride that he wants for his wife, that he's chosen, I choose her, father. The father and the son, they talk together about this beautiful woman that he's seen. And they discuss the covenant, the contract, the promises that they're going to make to this woman to convince her, to persuade her to say yes to him. Isn't this beautiful? Yeah. Yeah. Yes. But the most important part of this covenant, this contract, is the bridal price. How much are we willing to pay, Father? How much are we going to pay for her to become my bride? And then after the bridal price is decided, they come to the bride-to-be's home, and they present, the father and the son present to this woman the covenant, the promises. The man begins to tell her, I will love you, I will provide for you, I will take care of you, I will meet all your needs, I will do everything for you. You know, he begins to tell this woman what he's going to do for her if she would only say yes to him. Only say yes and become his bride. And then he tells her the price he's willing to pay, the sacrifice he's willing to make. if she would only say yes to him. And then he takes a cup. It's the cup of acceptance. It's a cup of wine. And he takes it and he puts it on a table between him and this bride. And he drinks half of the wine and he puts it back on the table. And then he sits there and he waits for whether or not this woman, this beautiful woman that he's fallen in love with, that he's pursuing, that he's trying to convince to say yes, will she drink the other half? Because in Jewish tradition, if she picks up that cup and drinks the other half of that wine, that is her saying, yes, I will be your bride. And in Jewish tradition, that is where the covenant comes together, and they are legally, if she decides to drink that cup, they become legally husband and wife. And if she says yes, then the Jewish man, he begins to adorn his bride with the gifts that he promised her. He begins to just adorn her with, you know, jewels and beautiful diamonds and you know, just adorns her. And then that's called the bridal gifts. And then after he's adorned her with everything that he has and given to her as a token of everything I have belongs to you, he steps back, he looks at his bride, and he says, you are so beautiful. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And I'm going to come back when it's ready. And then we are going to spend forever together. And so the Jewish man, this has happened in the past. This is the process of a Jewish man. And so him and his father go away, and he begins to build a home for his bride. And when the father and the son agree that the home is ready, he goes back and he gets his bride. And they come to this home, and they are living together forever. And when they come out of this home, there's a great marriage celebration. The whole town, the whole world is celebrating the unity of this husband and this wife. Did you hear the beautiful gospel story in that? That's exactly what Jesus has done for us. A covenant was made, him and the Father, because Jesus only does what he hears his Father do, right? He only says what he hears his Father say, right? And so they made this covenant together, and this is what it was. You ready for it? You ready to hear the covenant he made so that he could persuade your heart? So that he could say, will you let me be your husband? Will you become my bride? Will you say yes to me and become one with me? So that you no longer have to live in shame and fear another day in your life? This is why Jesus came. The Bible says the whole world was under condemnation. Did you know that? The whole world is under condemnation and shame. And Jesus came to rescue us. He came to rescue us from the accusing voices that tell us that we're not good enough. The accusing voices that tell us we lack in some way. The accusing voices that tell us you don't deserve God's promises. The accusing voices that tell us they're better than you. God loves them more than you. He came to deliver and rescue us from the shame of our mistakes, the shame that causes us to identify with what we've done wrong. He doesn't want us to identify with what we've done wrong anymore. He said, become one with me and identify yourself with who I am. Because if you say yes to me, you are Mrs. I am. No longer are you identified by your mistakes and the things that you think make you fall short. But he came with the covenant, and this is the beautiful, listen to this. Hebrews 8. Hebrews 8, 6 through 12, or maybe 13, if you have it. I don't have that in my notes, so if you don't put it up there, I won't be able to read it. Okay. Woo! Glory! All right. Can you put the New Living Translation up there? No, you don't have it? No, it's okay. I'm going to just read it from here. You all can read it from there. But now Jesus, our high priest, has been given a ministry that is far superior to the old priesthood. For he is the one who mediates for us a far better covenant with God based on better promises. Okay, now I'm going to have to read verse 7. Put verse 7 up there. For if the first covenant had been without defect, there would be no room for another one or an attempt to institute another one. Verse 8. However, he finds fault with them, showing its inadequacy. When he says, behold, the days will come, says the Lord, when I will make and ratify what?
A new
Woo! A new covenant or agreement with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Verse 9. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their forefathers on the day when I grasped them by the hand to help and relieve them and to lead them out from the land of Egypt. For they did not abide in my agreement with them, says the Lord. So I withdrew my favor and disregarded them, says the Lord. Verse 10. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will imprint my laws upon their minds and upon their innermost thoughts and understanding. And I will engrave them upon their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Verse 11. And it will never more be necessary for each one to teach his neighbor and his fellow citizen, or each one his brother, saying, know the Lord, for all will know me, from the smallest to the greatest. For I will be merciful and gracious toward their sins, and I will remember their deeds of unrighteousness no more. Amen. You know, the old covenant said you had to do something in order to be blessed, right? The old covenant said if you obey all God's commandments, you'll be blessed. If you disobey his commands, you'll be cursed, right? We didn't keep that covenant. None of us did. None of us could be righteous enough in our own works and our own goodness. And so Jesus came to persuade our hearts that I'm going to fulfill this for you. What you couldn't do, I'm going to do for you. And then I'm going to die upon a cross to take the penalty for you not being able to keep all the laws and commands. And then he says, I will write my laws upon your heart and upon your mind. And, you know, I asked the Lord one time, what does that mean? I will write my laws upon, you know, is that the, you know, do not love the Lord your God with all your heart. Do not lie. Do not commit. You know, is that what you're talking about? Because that was written on stone, right? And Jesus showed me. He said, no, Connie. He said, and he showed me in Romans 7, verse 12. He said, the law, my law, is holy. And it's just, and it's good. And I'm going to write upon your heart that you are holy, and you are just, and you are good. I'm going to convict you of righteousness every single day. I'm going to tell you how beautiful you are every single day, that I see no flaw in you every single day. I'm going to write that upon your heart, that you are holy, just, and good. And then he says, there's not going to be any need for you to know me through a pastor, through a Bible study teacher, through, you know, we're not going to know him through somebody else. We're going to have our own personal, intimate relationship with him. Because the ones who teach, the pastor and the Bible study teacher is going to point you to Jesus. No longer are we going to point you to ourselves and say, listen to me, I got all the answers. And if you listen to me, you'll have the anointing that I have. No, we're going to tell you that you are anointed because you're one with the one who is anointed. We're going to tell you that all your sins are forgiven. There's nothing between you and him. And you're going to run to the throne of grace and say, you love me. You really love me. There really is no fault in me. The only way you're going to get to know God intimately is if you believe this part of his covenant marriage vow to you. I will not remember your sins. I will forgive all of your sins. And I will never bring them up. Never bring them up. I will never bring up your faults. Listen, when I was married to my husband, this was 30-some years ago, we read our vows. Somebody gave us some vows to read. And I remember this one little line that he read to me. Can't remember anything else. And he said, all to you, my earthly goods, do I bestow. And I remembered that marriage vow. I've remembered it every single day since he said it. And when he tells me something is his, I'm like, I'm Mrs. Connie Witter. And that means everything that Tony Witter has belongs to me. That was your marriage vow. And I remind him a lot about it. But could you imagine if on our wedding day, he looked at me and he said, I will never remember your sins. I'll never bring up your mistakes. I'll never see any fault in you. You will only be beauty itself to me. I will never be angry at you. I will never rebuke you. Could you imagine if that was his marriage vow to me? I would have fallen, deeply in love. I mean, you can't help but fall in love with somebody who says, I mean, can you imagine? This is the kind of love we're searching for. This is the kind of love we all long for somebody to love us just where we are, with all our mistakes, with all our failures, with all of our, things that, and tell us, you're wonderful. You're beautiful. I see no flaw in you. And we go tilt, but you know everything, Father. But you know everything, Jesus. Didn't you not see what I just did? But he made a marriage vow to you. I just read it to you in my Bible. It's in your Bible too. And we get to decide whether we're going to believe it. Because when you believe it, you live free. You live free from shame. You live free from fear. No longer are you thinking, do I measure up? No longer are you thinking, am I as good as them? If my sins are forgiven and he's never going to bring them up, and your sins are forgiven and he's never going to, you know what that makes us? Equal. We're equally righteous, equally forgiven, equally loved, equally favored. Because it's not about us. It's about him. He's given us his identity. So when the enemy comes to try to accuse us, let me tell you something. When he comes and tries to tell you that you're not good enough, that you don't measure up, that your needs aren't going to get met, that you're not a good wife, that you're not a good husband, that you're not a good parent, when he comes and tells you these lies, they're all lies. When he accuses you and he tries to get you under condemnation, you say, no. I know who I am. My Jesus had made a marriage vow to me. And he said that he would remind me every day that I'm righteous and that I'm holy and that I'm good. I am a good husband. I am a good wife. I am a good parent because Jesus says I am. And the more you believe it, guess what will come out of your life? Goodness. Because as a man or a woman thinketh in his heart, so is he. And you know, really, the beauty of the gospel is that we do all fail at times. We all forget who we are, do we not? Yes. When we get into fear, into shame, when we get aggravated and angry at each other, when we're judging somebody and has a negative opinion of somebody, we have forgotten who we are. And we don't need somebody to come and point out how bad we are. What we need is, like Jesus promised, to be reminded that we're righteous and good and without fault in his sight. You know, I was sharing yesterday at the conference that I had a little issue with my Victoria. She's my youngest child, and I have four wonderful children, and she's my last one. She just turned 18 in November and graduating this May. And we have a curfew for her. And she has recently, a few times in a row, come in late on her curfew. And I have taught all of my children since understanding of grace who they are. I never go to them and say, you're bad or anything like that. I always say, Victoria, you are respectful. You honor your mom and dad because that's who you are. She doesn't do that to be good. She is that. She is good. And if she's not doing it, she's just forgotten who she is. She needs to be reminded. So anyhow, her daddy had told her, if you come in late one more time, you're going to be grounded. So she came in late one more time. And this is right when I was here at the conference. But she was only 2 minutes late. Come on now, right? 2 minutes? And daddy grounded her for 2 weeks. Now, Mama wants to go, that isn't right. You know, I'm wanting to take Victoria's side. I'm wanting to be judgmental and think towards my husband. What are you doing? This is not good. You're going to cause her to rebel. I mean, all these fearful thoughts were going on in my heart. It wasn't peace. It wasn't being free from fear and free from shame. It was like, oh, Lord. See, I wanted to go into fix-it mode. And I wanted to go into savior mode. And I wanted to, you know, tell my husband this and tell my daughter this and try to bring peace back. And, you know, I'm married to the Prince of Peace, but I'm not the Prince of Peace. And so my daughter, she is calling me saying, you know, or actually she's texting me. Oh, she and called me because she texted me and wasn't getting enough response. So she calls me too. You know, she's like, I need you to talk to Dad. This is not right. You know, I need you to rescue me. I need, you know, she didn't say those, but that's what she's saying. I need you to rescue me. I need you to be my savior. I need you to convince Dad that he has been unjust with me. 2 minutes, Mom. I was only 2 minutes late. And I'm thinking to myself, yeah, that is pretty harsh. But I didn't say that. I stepped back. My husband's calling me and texting me. I'm stepping back, and I'm remembering. I'm married to the Prince of Peace. This will change your life forever. Hear me. We are married to the Prince of Peace. And he does a really great job of bringing peace into every situation if we're willing to let him be the Savior. If we're willing to let him be the rescuer and the deliverer. I tell you what, sometimes I've been like, oh, Jesus, I'll take care of this one. And guess what? It turns into a big, fat mess. It's the biggest mess you ever saw. When Connie Witter tries to be the rescue and savior of her family, of her children, and of her husband, it doesn't turn out well. Then I have to run back to Jesus and go, you see no fault in me. I need you to rescue me from trying to be the rescuer. You know, I do. I have to go back and say, Lord, I've forgotten. I've forgotten who you are. I've forgotten who I am, but you still love me. And even though I've made a huge mess here, you are still going to rescue me. And you're still going to redeem this mess I made. And you're still going to bring the peace into this situation. I just had to go through a little hard stuff because I tried to get myself in it, which I could have avoided, you know what I'm saying, if I would have just said, Jesus, you're going to bring peace here. So anyways, my daughter's talking to me, and I say to her, I ask Jesus. I say, you're the Prince of Peace, Jesus. I only say what I hear you say. What do you want me to say to my daughter? Because honestly, the flesh wants to take sides with her. I'm just being honest. The flesh wants to take sides with her. The flesh wants to also tell her, you know, your daddy said this. You should have been in time. This is the consequence, blah, 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 blah. You know, and there's nothing wrong with saying this is the consequence for what was done. There's nothing wrong with it. It's the spirit in which you do it. It's really just the spirit in which you say it. And I texted her after Jesus told me what to say. He says, Connie, I want you to remind Victoria who she is. Because that's his marriage vow to us. To remind us of who we are, even when we've done wrong. That is what's going to persuade our hearts. That's what's going to cause our mind to change. That's what's going to cause us to repent. Not like repent, I'm so sorry for my sins. But repent in what we're believing. It's a change of our mind from, I'm the Savior. No, Jesus is the Savior. You know? Change of mind to the judgmental thoughts towards the people involved to, Jesus, you love them. You're going to remind them who they are. You said you'd be their teacher and you'd give them great peace. Do you see how we can live in peace? Just by looking to the Prince of Peace in every situation? So I texted my daughter, and I simply said, Victoria, you are wonderful. You are a very, very good girl. And Mama is so proud of you. I said, you are respectful towards your daddy, and you honor him even when you don't agree with the decisions that he's made. Because that is who you are. That's who Jesus made you, Victoria. So I encourage you, just ask Jesus to help you. Ask him to help you walk out who you are, and this will all work out for your good. And she's like, okay, Mom. And she said, I already asked him to help me, Mom. Isn't that sweet?
Yeah.
I'm like, thank you, Father, that my children can know Jesus personally too. They don't have to know him through their mama, yeah. Right? But anyway, the very next day, I had a very brief conversation with my husband, very brief. It was not, you know, he just told me what had went on, and I said, okay, if that's what you decide, you know, I'll talk to you later. This was really late on the night that I came in. But the very next day, my daughter texts me, big words, Mom, like, you know, big capital Mom's exclamation. She's texting me because she tried to call me, and I didn't catch her phone call. And I'm thinking, oh, dear Lord, what's happened now, right? So I call her, and she proceeds to tell me how Daddy came to her and told her that that was too harsh of a punishment and that he was going to just have her, you know, stay home for a couple of days and that she needed to, you know, remember that her curfew was this time and be respectful of that time. And she says, Mom, I'm good with that. I'm good with that. And do you see how peace came?
Yeah.
Do you see how the Prince of Peace will bring peace into your situation when we step back for a moment?
Yeah.
We look to him. I am married to the Prince of Peace. And his covenant promise to me is he'll be my God. He'll be my husband. He'll be your husband. And you will be his bride. And he is the Prince of Peace. Thank you. Oh, my goodness, it's 11:30, and I haven't even gotten halfway. Jesus, help me. It's okay. Y'all are getting some good out of here, aren't you?
Amen.
Thank you, Father. The bridal price. I'm just going to run through these real quick. The bridal price. First of all, Jesus comes to you, and he tells you this beautiful covenant that I'll make with you. The bridal price that he paid proved the value that you have. In 2 Peter 1:18 through 19, it says, for you know God paid a ransom to save you from the empty life you inherited from your ancestors, and it was not paid with mere gold or silver, which lose their value. It was the precious blood of Christ, the sinless, spotless Lamb of God. You were so valuable to him. When he looked at you and he chose you. I love what Tawan was teaching yesterday about, you know, we go, oh, I chose you, Father, I chose you. No, he chose us. He chose us. He loved us first. He chose us first. He looked at you and said, I want Marcia. I want Nicole. I choose Trisha. I choose Jennifer. I choose Mark. He looked at each one of us and said, I choose you. And this is how much I'm willing to pay for you. All the silver and all the gold and all the world is not enough to pay for you because you're that valuable. I think about the diamond and the granite. You know, when you walk into a house and everything's granite and you're like, oh my goodness, this is really expensive. Do you know how many homes in the world have granite? That's rich, isn't it? It's worth a lot of money. But Jesus, you money can't even buy you. You're so valuable. And so many times we're getting our value from the position that we hold. We're getting our value from what people think of us, how much money we make, our social status, what we look like. But Jesus, he proved your value by the price he was willing to pay for you. Your value is not in the world system. Your value is in the kingdom of God, purchased with the precious blood of Jesus. Just say it. I am valuable.
I am worthy.
I am worth it. And Jesus proved it by paying for me with his life blood. That's where our value comes from. And let me tell you something real quick. This is, when we look to people and we get frustrated with them or aggravated with them or we get offended, oh gosh, offense is the hugest one. We get offended because they didn't talk to us, or because they didn't ask us to do something, or they didn't give us a position that we wanted. We are getting our value from the world system. That's why offense comes up, because we're looking outside of Jesus for our value. You're not valuable because somebody said hi to you. You're not important and appreciated because somebody said thank you to you. You're not important in this church because of a position that you hold.
That's right.
You are valuable, important, and special because you were purchased with the precious blood of Jesus. And when you really take on that value system, the King of Kings value system, offense dissipates. You don't have any offense. There is nothing to be offended by, because you are valuable, important, special. Not because of what somebody else says or does, but because of what your Jesus did for you. Your bridegroom who laid his life down to say you are valuable. Jesus in Matthew 26, 27 through 28, the cup of acceptance, says, "And he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and said, 'Eat, each of you drink from it. For this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice to forgive the sins of many.'" Jesus took the cup. Remember when he asked the Father, "Can you take this cup from me?" Do you remember that?
Yeah.
But then he said, "Not my will, Father, but yours be done." The cup that he was going to drink was the curse of the law for you. That was the cup he was going to drink. He was going to take the curse, the full punishment, the full curse of the law. The Bible says that Jesus redeemed us, purchased our freedom from the curse of the law. How? By becoming a curse for us. He drank the bitter cup of the curse of the law so that you could be made righteous and holy, so that the debt that was against you could be paid, so that the law had nothing on you anymore. The scripture says that what the writing that was against you was nailed to the cross. So the enemy has nothing on you anymore. He could come to you and say, "Look, you're not reading your Bible enough. Look at, you're not giving enough. Look at you. You're not being kind enough. Look at you. You're grouchy." I mean, this is all the law, right? He's bringing it to you. And you can say, "That has been nailed to the cross. You have nothing on me, devil. You have nothing on me. My Jesus became a curse so that I might be the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I am perfect and holy, not because of what I've done right, but because of what my Jesus did right. And he gave his rightness to me." Woo! That's freedom. The cup of acceptance. Now, the beautiful thing is we get to decide whether we're going to drink the other half. And this is a beautiful picture of communion. I mean, when I began to understand the cup of acceptance and that this was part of the marriage proposal that Jesus did as our bridegroom, communion for me now, when I drink that cup, I'm remembering his marriage vows to me.
Yeah.
I'm remembering the day that I said, "Yes, Jesus, you'll never count my sins against me. Yes, Jesus, you are my Savior. You are my deliverer. You are my protector. You are my righteousness. You are the one who loves me completely and utterly to the uttermost. With everything I am, you love me." Communion is about remembering the marriage covenant. Oh my goodness, do you see this? Communion is about remembering the sacrifice Jesus made to take away all our sin, to become one with us, so that we could live as Mrs. I Am. But we get to decide whether we're going to say yes to it. I love the understanding that the gospel is not an arranged marriage. He doesn't force you into relationship with him. He doesn't force you to say yes to him. He loves you. He persuades you. He pursues you. And he says, "Will you say yes to me? I want to be your rescuer. I want to be your deliverer. I want to be one with you. Will you say yes to me?" And you know that day when we said yes to Jesus and we became his bride, and you'll always be his bride. He's never going to leave you. He's never going to forsake you. No matter how mad you are at him, no matter, like Tawan says, she cusses at him, you know, no matter if she cusses at him, he is never going to leave you. He's never going to forsake you. You said yes to him, and you're stuck to him like glue, and he ain't never letting you go. You had one chance to say no, and you didn't do it, so you're in. You're in. Amen? You're secure in this marriage covenant. It ain't never going to be broken. For what God has brought together, let no man separate. Woo! That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. And every day, we get the opportunity to say yes to Jesus. Every day. Now, you're never, again, your identity is never going to change, but you experiencing the peace that he offers, you experiencing the freedom that he paid for, has everything to do with you saying yes to him every single day. The ways that we say no is, I'm not good enough. We're saying no to Jesus. When we say, I can't do it, we're saying no to Jesus. When we say, I'm not a success, we're saying no to Jesus, because Jesus says, yes, you are a success. Yes, you can do all things through me. Yes, you are beautiful. Yes, you are good. Yes, you are perfect. And until we come into agreement with him, we're saying no to our husband, the King of Kings. And as long as we're saying no to him, we don't experience the peace that he promises us. Right? Is this true? I've been a bride for 40-some years, and I promise you I didn't live in no peace. For 20 years, I was living under the law, trying my hardest to be as good as I could be, feeling like I was unworthy, living in shame. And my Jesus told me that if I was his bride, I would no longer live in shame. Why was I living in shame? Because every day I was saying no. Every day when, you know, I didn't know who I was. I didn't really even understand I was saying no. You don't even understand you're saying no sometimes. As a matter of fact, the Lord just showed me, just this, on this trip to Thailand, you know, having the ministry and the resources that he's provided us with and the message that he has for us, I want the whole world to know this message, don't you? Yes. And so there's this word, it's called marketing. And it's the word in the world, marketing, is how can we get this message, how can we get these resources to as many people as possible, that as many people as possible know, right? And I would have meetings with my staff and tell them, you know, this is the area that we need to, you know, think about, and how can we get these things out. But in my heart, this is what I thought, and I didn't even realize I was thinking this. Oh, my goodness. So sometimes we're saying no, and we don't even realize we're saying no. But if we're not experiencing, peace in a situation, it's because we're saying no to Jesus. But in my heart, this is what I thought, and I even said this. We are failing at this marketing thing. Wouldn't I, Marcia? We are failing. Who was I looking to?
We. We are failing.
You know, and then my beautiful friends who I love so much, I honestly would be tempted. They're not doing enough. I'm not doing enough. You know, come on. We need to get this together. We need to... We, not Jesus, 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 Jesus. You hear me? When we met Joseph Prince this last, you know, couple weeks ago, and I'm sitting in this room, I did nothing to make this happen. It was effortless. It was like, this is Jesus. Nobody can take credit for this. This is like the impossible happening right here. 4 hours he sat with us. Jesus spoke to his heart, Joseph Prince, and said, I want you to meet with the women of grace when they come into town. I want you to meet with them. How does he even know who we are? Well, Jesus does. And we're married to the King of Kings. And I'm sitting in this circle, and Jesus lovingly corrects me. He says, Connie, you've been saying that you're a failure at this marketing thing. He's so wonderful, isn't he? Because he does it with such sweetness. I was talking to Pastor Mark yesterday. It's the sweet sound of correction. I love to be corrected when I know I'm loved. Because he's not telling me how bad I am. He's reminding me who I am. And he said, you are one with me. I'm going to open the doors for you. I'm going to make these things happen for you. In my timing, it's all going to come. You rest, and you only do what you hear me say do. And you only say what you hear me say, and I will open the doors. And peace came. I came back and told my staff, you know, we're done with this. Jesus is our marketer. Jesus is the one that's going to open the doors. Jesus is going to take care of this. We are going to sit back and watch him do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ever hope or dream. Because what we want the most is just for the masses to hear this good news. And you know what? He wants it even more than we do. Why we struggle? Why we, you know, when we're married to the King of Kings? The bridal gifts. Once we say yes to Jesus, he showers us with the gift of righteousness, the gift of salvation, the gift of peace. My peace I give with you, not as the world gives, I give to you. It's not the peace that comes when everything's perfect and right. It's the peace that comes in the midst of a storm. The peace he gives isn't shaken when you're in a plane like we were that felt like it was going to crash. The peace that he gives doesn't waver if the economy is going down. The peace he gives doesn't shake in its boots when our children are making wrong decisions. The peace he gives is a peace that comes from the King of Kings. And he says, I'm going to take care of you, my bride. I'm going to take care of everything that concerns you. You don't have to worry about anything. And you don't have to live another day in shame. For you are my bride. You are one with me. He showers you with righteousness. I will rejoice in the Lord my God. For he has covered me with clothing of salvation. He's robed me in a robe of righteousness as a bridegroom adorns his bride. We got nothing to worry about. We got nothing to fear. He's removed all shame from us. We can live in confidence in this world because we are loved. We are loved by the King of Kings. And perfect love, it casts out all fear. All he wants us to do is say yes to him. He just wants us to say yes. All of his promises are yes and amen in Christ Jesus. So when he says, yes, my love, I'm going to take care of you. Say yes, Jesus. You're going to take care of me. When he says, yes, my beloved, I'm going to provide for you. I'm going to protect you. I'm going to teach your children, and they're going to enjoy great peace. Say yes, Jesus. You're my husband. I am one with you. You're going to take care of my children. They're going to enjoy great peace. You're going to protect me because that's your marriage vow to me, and you're a faithful husband. We're married to the great Savior of the whole world. You're one with the Deliverer, the Rescuer, the Refuge, the Fortress, the God in whom we can trust. He wants you to know. He wants you to be free. And we live free when we believe our true identity. The identity that he's given to us. We're the favored one, the protected one, the loved one, the one that's without fault, the one who's been made righteous. And he has gone to prepare a place for us. He looks at us right now. He says, oh, my bride, everything I have belongs to you. But there's one more thing that's going to be taken care of, and that is physical death. Did you know that? No more death. No more crying. No more tears. He's going to prepare a place for us where there's no more trials, no more trouble, no more crying. Isn't that wonderful? That we can live in this world fully confident, fearless, shameless, because we're Mrs. I Am. Knowing that someday we're going to be in a place where there is no more trials, there is no more tears, there is no more loss. Jesus has gone to prepare a place for us. Amen. And he's coming back, our bridegroom, to take us to live with him forever. In the meantime, we're going to live as the bride of Christ. We're going to live free from fear. We're going to live free from shame because we're going to say yes to Jesus every single day in every situation. and we're going to experience His perfect peace because we are married to the Prince of Peace. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Heavenly Father, I thank you that they'll never forget what I spoke about today. That every man, woman, and child in this room will remember that they are married to you. They are one with you. That they are one with the Prince of Peace. And that whenever our peace is shaken, or whenever fear tries to come, whenever shame tries to come, that we know that we can run to you, Jesus. We can run to you, and you will remind us that we are loved, that we are beautiful, that we are faultless, and that we're married to the great Savior of the whole world. Thank you, Jesus, for being our peace. Thank you for helping us walk and live in the peace that you paid such a great price for us to live in. In Jesus' name.